the mind of the agent, but this reflection is going to be always distorted. He said, in the same way that we cannot judge a man for the idea that we have of himself, in the same way we cannot judge a whole historical period by the ideological representation that people intervening in it develop. So that we have on the one hand the objective meaning of history, on the other hand, the specifically antagonistic moment has been spirited away because what appears to be a clash, a chasm, impossible to supersede between social force, in fact has an objective meaning which escaped the consciousness of the agents. Now, this is important to see that this debate about antagonism and this notion of history as unified by an objectivity which escaped a finite consciousness is something which has a theological root. In fact, the whole Hegelian enterprise is rooted in some, let's say, in some debates which took place at the beginning of Christianity. The question which posed itself to the fathers of the church was the following. God is, on the one hand, almighty, and on the other hand, is absolute goodness. In that case, how do I explain the existence of evil in the world? Because either of two possible answers, either God is not responsible for the existence of evil in the world, in which case he could be absolute goodness, but he's not almighty, or he can be responsible for the existence of evil in the world, in which case he is almighty, but not absolute goodness. So, how to solve this problem? There were different attempts. None of them was really successful. St. Augustine gives several solutions that he himself recognized that his solutions are not good, and he concludes by saying that the problem is that the signs of God are inscrutable and that we should not be asking ourselves that type of questions, which is the way of saying stop asking awkward questions. So there was only one type of answer which is internally coherent and which is going to be the prehistory of the Hegelian system. And this was the attempt in the 9th century during the Carolingian Renaissance by John Scotus Eugenius giving an answer to this problem. And the answer of Scotus Eugenius is that evil does not actually exist. That what appears to us as evil is in fact only one stage through which God had to pass in order to reach his absolute perfection. So, for us who are within the process of history, finite consciousness, the process appears as dominated by evil. But from the point of view of the self-realization of God, evil is does not exist. Now, of course, the Eugenia did not realize that his assertion was incompatible with even the loosest forms of orthodoxy, because in order to propose this solution, he had to say that God is not perfect from eternity, that he needs a process in order to the other hand, if God needs the world to pass through all these stages to reach his own perfection, he has to be, to some extent, internal to the world. And there he is clearly bordering pantheism. Later on, his propositions after his death were condemned by the Vatican. But is true is that all this type of analysis is all this type of approach is going to have a long successful philosophical heritage. We are going to find this analysis in the northern mysticism of the 14th century. You will find it in Eckhart, Suso, and others. You are going later on to find it in Nicholas Cusanus, in the Doctor Ignorantia. You are going to find it later on in Spinoza, in Hegel, and in Marx. So, this is the vision according to which the only way addressing antagonism is on the basis of of suppressing the specifically antagonistic moment and subsuming it under an objectivity transcending all finite consciousness. Now, here I have presented to you the internal difficulties of the Hegelian dialectic, but these difficulties also are to be found in the theological tradition preceding it, because what we call in a secularized language antagonism was before the problem of evil in the theological language. For instance, in Plotinus, you have the question of how the one, which is absolute perfect, needed to transcend into through successive hypostases into a less and less perfect reality. How the most perfect, through this transition, reaches the less perfect. And he was unable to produce a proper answer. And in the Christian, who had been impregnated by Neoplatonism, the same difficulty appeared. Why did God need to create a world? If he was self-sufficient and perfect, how he need to embark in this complicated process, which is creation? So, obviously this question was never properly answered, and I think is the lack of answer is inherent to all radically immanentist version of the unity of the historical process or the on a monist kind of cosmology. So, if things are like that, what I would like to do in the last part of this presentation is to discuss what are the consequences which follow from taking the opposite route. That is to say, from denying the existence of a third man from which the meaning of history as a totality is revealed, which means that in that case we are going to have that antagonism, the negativity internal to antagonism, is irreducible, and that the only type of consciousness that we are going to have in history is the consciousness of the finite agents participating in it. I think we can find some general consequence of adopting this perspective. In the first place, there is no possibility of speaking about a single space of representation. If the two poles of the antagonism are irreducible to a deeper objectivity, in that case the two poles are not integrated with each other. This is what I was alluding previously when I said that in antagonism we don't have an objective relation, but a relation in which the limits of objectivity as such are shown. Society does not manage to be a purely objective social order because the presence of antagonism prevents it from achieving this this ultimate objective. So, in the first place, representation has its limits. Now, the limits of representation have been explored in many directions. For instance, the ontological difference of Heidegger, the notion of Abgrund, are aspects which necessarily inhere in the in a conception of social antagonism which does not try to do away with the caste massacre. So this would be a first aspect. The second aspect is that this leads us to the notion of radical investment. This is a problem that I have addressed especially in my book Emancipation, and I want to say something about it, linking it with this problem that we are discussing today. The question is to what extent we can have a representation of social totality which closes itself around a certain center. If you present the problem from a linguistic perspective, the question is how a system of differences, which for Saussure was essential in any in any structure of signification, how the system of difference can be achieved. Firstly, we find that in order to achieve a total system of differences, you have to establish the limit of the system. But in order to establish the limit of something, you have to see something which is beyond the limit. Without seeing what is beyond the limit, you cannot see a limit. And as this is the system of all the differences, this limit, element which is outside the limit, you cannot decide whether it's going to be internal to the system or external to the system. So one possibility is to say that this is an excluded element, that that society managed to constitute itself as a totality simply by excluding something as the radically other, which made possible the building up of this limit. In a text that I have studied by Saint-Just during the French Revolution, Saint-Just said, the unity of the Republic is the destruction of what is opposed to it, that is to say, the aristocratic flow. Only by excluding something, I managed to reach a certain unity. But this leads us to another difficulty, and this difficulty is that from the point of view of the relation with excluded element, all the elements of the system are not